Hi, and welcome back to Scandinavian Design 101.
Hello.
I'm Sanna.
I'm Andreas. And we are two Swedes. Mm. And we really love Scandinavian design.
We really do. And we want to teach you more about it.
Yes. And today, we're going to talk about one specific piece of design. Mm. And that's the Artichoke lamp by Poul Henningsen.
A very fascinating person.
Yeah. And this lamp is quite spectacular, I think.
It is.
I think you've seen it, but it has a quite interesting story behind it, so it will be interesting to talk about this.
We think so.
Yeah,
we hope you will enjoy it. Let's start with a few words about Poul Henningsen.
Yes.
But we're not going to talk that much about him.
No,
perhaps. Because focuses on the artichoke, but some
we can't help it.
The man behind the artichoke, but also the man behind lamps like the PH5 and the three shaded lamp system. You've seen a lot of his works.
Yeah,
I can be sure. He was a really fascinating person and absolutely not just a lamp designer, even though it was the lamps who made him famous all around the world. One can call Henningsen a lot of things.
Yeah.
Inventor, author, journalist, musician, painter, politician, and of course, designer.
Yeah.
And already at the age of 18, he invented a self-propelled bicycle. And that is a weird thing.
Yeah.
To invent, but practical.
Good thing.
And his first lamps he designed only a few years later. In the 20s, he produced the left-wing magazine Kritisk Revy, criticizing the Danish society. So he had a lot of layers.
Definitely. And in 1924, he came in contact with Sophus Kostrup Olsen. I think it's pronounced, it's a Danish man. he was the owner of the lighting company Louis Poulsen. And this was extremely important for Henningsen's career as a lamp designer. Mm. And as you know, Louis Poulsen is still today producing a lot of Henningsen lamps.
Is it Louis? Not Louis.
Louis, I think.
But was he French or was he Danish?
Louis or Louis Poulsen. I'm not really sure how to pronounce it.
I want to say the S though.
Yeah, let's say Louis Poulsen.
During the Second World War, the left-wing Henningsen was highly critical against the Nazi regime, but who the fuck wasn't?
No.
and he fought the Nazis with music and theater.
That's a good idea.
Shortly after the German invasion of Denmark in the 1940, he fled to neutral Sweden together with architect colleague Arne Jakobsen. Mm-hmm. The men and their wives rode in a small boat over Öresund, a strait of water. I don't know exactly what it's called, but it's a strait and it's water between Denmark and Sweden.
Yeah.
It's been said that they were greeted on the beach in Sweden by Alvar Aalto, who also sought refuge in Sweden during the war.
Yeah.
But we don't know if that's true, but
the legend says so.
The legend. And now to the lamps.
Yeah.
The artichoke, or Koglen?
Koglen.
Kogeln.
Kogeln. In Danish.
In Danish, yeah. Kotten in Swedish. It means tree cone.
Yeah, so it's not artichoke in Swedish.
No, exactly. It was designed in the late 1950s, but the history of this classic piece of design starts much earlier than that. Therefore, we will first take a look at another of Henningsen's classic lamp, the glass lamp Septima.
Yeah, you see it here.
Mm. In the late fall of 1926, Henningsen had developed a system of three shaded lamps, possible to combine in many variations.
Yeah.
We will show you a short video about the principles behind this lamp system.
Yes.
Right now.
Yeah.
Thank you.
As a development of the tree shade system, the Septima was designed by Henningsen between 1927 and 1931. So it took a few years to design this lamp. It was quite advanced. And the first prototype was exhibited in the fall of 1928 at the Danish Museum of Decorative Art in Copenhagen. Septima was based on a PH5/5 pendant lamp.
What does that even mean?
Yeah, it had a diameter of 50 centimeters approximately. But Henningsen placed an additional 4 extra shades between the original 3, so it was 7 shades in total, made from glass with alternately clear and frosted segments on each shade. And this lamp, it didn't spread the light very much, so it could feel a bit blinding when you looked at it. Mm-hmm. So as a result of this, only low watt light bulbs could be used.
So it's kind of dark.
Yeah, quite a dark room. But in 1929, an amber-colored glass shade were introduced, giving the Septima a more pleasant light. And then 2 years later, also pink version was actually introduced. And I think there was a blue one too, but I've never seen it. I just read about it. So it must be extremely rare. And then in 1931, Henningsen introduced a smaller version than based on a PH4/4 lamp. So it was approximately 40 centimeters in diameter. But he also, and this is the interesting thing, considered a metal version of the Septima. Mm. And this was never put in production, but sketches of this lamp shows a lamp looking very much like the artichoke lamp. Mm. But then, in the 1940s, in the early 1940s, the Septima was discontinued by Louis Poulsen due to a shortage of material during the World War.
Of course, of course.
Yeah.
Now, to the artichoke.
To the artichoke.
In 1956, the Danish architects Eva and Niels Koppel were commissioned to design the new restaurant, Lange Linje Paviljongen.
Yeah.
That's... I'm not even going to say it, because it's a weird name.
In any language.
Yeah. It was at the waterfront in the central Copenhagen, and this was actually the third Lange Linje Pavilion. The first was built already in 1884 and functioned as a combined cafe, restaurant, and yacht club for the fancy people.
Yeah, it was.
This building was demolished in 1901 and replaced by another much larger building. During the Second World War, the pavilion was destroyed. As a result of a design competition, Eva and Niels Koppel were given the task of designing a new pavilion scheduled to be ready in 1958.
Yeah.
They soon gave Henningsen the task of designing the lamps for the building. He immediately started sketching lamps that combined the required function with a festive feeling.
Yeah, well, that's a good thing.
Festive. I like that word, festive. One of these lamps were the artichoke, and it was developed surprisingly quickly. And why was that? Yeah. Well, because of the Septima we already talked about.
Yes.
And more specifically, the metal one.
Yes.
That were not produced at that time.
No.
One can say that the artichoke is the Septima combined with the experiences Henningsen got from designing the PH5 lamps.
Yes, and you've seen the PH5 lamp, all of you. And the artichoke consists of 72 metal blades held together by 12 metal arms forming a spear in the middle of the lamp. And the lamp produced to the Lange Linje Pavilion had a diameter of 84 centimeters, so it was a huge lamp. And it was made from brushed copper. But soon, I mean, they understood that they needed smaller lamps for, like, normal homes and so on. You can't have this 1 meter lamp at home.
It's difficult.
So they soon introduced two smaller artichokes, one with a diameter of 72 centimeters and one with a 60 centimeter diameter.
It's still big.
Yeah, it's still big. But today you can buy a small one that's 48 centimeters in diameter, and that's quite good for a normal home, I think. And it's interesting to note that all original artichokes were made from copper.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't until the mid-1970s that the stainless steel version was introduced. And today, by some reason, many artichokes seen are white.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not really sure why. I think when we sold a lot of artichokes at auction, when we worked in an auction house, we saw a lot of white artichokes. I think it's a bit because of they were used in public spaces and they should be neutral or something. So they used the white artichoke.
Isn't it the whole Scandinavian vibe?
Yeah, it should be white and
everything
bright.
Is white
and,
or beige and yeah. Gray. And...
Yeah, but it's important to note then that the white artichoke was introduced not until 1980. Mm. And that was the same year as the stainless steel version was discontinued. But it's very important to understand that during the lifetime of Poul Henningsen, all artichokes were made from copper and copper alone.
Hmm.
And Henningsen himself thought that the artichoke should be a copper lamp.
Hmm.
But this changed, as we saw, after the death of Henningsen. And this is not a unique situation. Often companies tend to change the production when a designer dies.
Mm.
The same thing happened with, for example, Arne Jacobsen when he died, because he thought that his classic ant chair, it should only have three legs.
Mm.
So he forbid it. He said Fritz Hansen, uh-huh. They were not allowed to produce it with four legs, even though the customers really wanted a four-legged, more stable chair. But immediately after his death, they started to produce a four-legged ant chair.
Mm.
And I don't really know what to think about it, but it's a fact, I think. And today... The artichoke is a well-recognized piece of design, of course,
really
represented at museums like MoMA in New York, as well as, I mean, public spaces all around the world. But it's not a very cheap lamp. The big one, the 84 centimeter one in copper, is about $20,000 each new. So that's very much money.
That is a crazy amount.
And it's a better idea to buy a used one at auction.
It's always a better idea. Don't buy new stuff.
No. And if you buy a copper one, they will look great when they are old. They age gracefully and they are very beautiful. And they are cheap compared to the new one.
Mm.
I mean, the lamp at auction is about $3,000 or $4,000. So it's much cheaper than to buy a new one.
So that's the conclusion.
Yeah.
Buy at auctions.
Yeah. And it's...
Buy the artichoke.
And it's an interesting lamp.
Don't buy the white one.
No, buy a copper one. The artichoke is, I mean, it comes from the nature, and this copper artichoke, it feels almost organic or living, especially when it has this scratches and this rustic.
But
and
where
so
is
on.
Copper found in nature, though?
Yeah.
Well, Poul Henningsen is a fantastic person, and we, of course, are going to talk about him more.
Yes.
In later episodes.
Yes.
But today you will have to do with just the artichoke and yeah. some history.
Yes.
Hope you learned something new today. And if you did, and if you liked it, please click the thumbs up button and subscribe if you want to.
Yes, and if you're interested in Scandinavian design, please follow our Instagram account. We're called Scandinavian Design 101.
You can learn a lot of stuff there.
Yes.
I do.
Yeah, daily posts about Scandinavian design
Fantastic.
And modern design.
Fantastic.
Yeah, thanks for watching.
Bye.